Ladies and gentlemen, announcing the arrival of Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Sri Idris Jalan, Chairman of Pemandu Associate, accompanied by VVIPs. Please rise and give a big hand to Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Sri Idris Jalan. Guests are requested to remain standing for the national anthem Negaraku and the state anthem of Perak. Gentlemen, kindly be seated. Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Sri Idris Jalan, President and Chairman of Pemandu Associate and Wife, Yang Berbahagia, Datin Sri Pangan Yue. Yang Berbahagia, Profesor Dato' Dr. Man Amin bin Maktaf, Vice Chancellor, University Pendidikan Sultan Idris and Wife, Yang Berbahagia, Datin Fazilah Yahya. Yang Berusaha, Profesor Dr. Abdul Rahim Razali, Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic and International, UPSI. UPSIS Top Management, Yang Berusaha, Associate Professor Dr. Muhammad Asri Muhammad Noor, Dean, Faculty of Management and Economic, UPSI. Industry Representative, ladies and gentlemen.
Assalamualaikum and good evening. Welcome to our prestigious event today.
Captain of the industry, the other side of me.
Talk series with Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Sri Idris Jalan. Ladies and gentlemen, let us begin our event with the recitation of doa. I would like to invite Dr. Ahmad Zakiruwah bin Muhammad Syarani to lead us with the recitation of dua. Please welcome.
الفاتحة. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم إنا نسألك سلامة في الدين، وعافية في الجسد، وزيادة في العلم، وبركة في الرزق، وتوبة قبل الموت، ورحمة عند الموت، ومغفرة بعد الموت. اللهم هون علينا في سكرات الموت والنجاة من النار والعفو عند الحساب. يا الله، we gather today to express gratitude upon your greatest gift toward us. In conjunction with this program, Captain of the Industry, The Other Side of Me Talks Series 2.0, with Yang Berbahagia Datuk Seri Idris Jalla, the President and Chairman of the Pemandu Associates, we ask for your help and guidance. Ya Allah, kindly give us strength and courage to face all the challenges and gain a wide range of knowledge. Ya Allah, Ya Aziz, Ya Qahar, Ya Jabbar, Ya Rabbal Alamin. Ya Allah, give strength to our leaders to continue to serve for people, society, nation and religion. Ya Allah, make our country a country that got the blessing of a lasting peace and prosperity of all time. Allahumma ja'al jam'ana hadha jam'an marhuma. وَتَفَرَّقْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِ تَفَرُّقًا مَّعْصُومًا وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِينَا وَلَا مَعَنَا شَقِيًّا وَلَا مَحْرُومًا وَلَا مَطْرُودًا رَبَّنَا عَلَيْكَ تَوَكَّلْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَبَارِكَ وَسَلَّمَ والحمد لله رب العالمين تقبل الله منكم.
آمين آمين يا رب العالمين. Thank you for that heartfelt and meaningful dua. May your words resonate with each one of us as we continue with the event.
Let us move to our next agenda. A welcoming speech by our event host, Yang Berusaha, Associate Professor Dr. Muhammad Asri Muhammad Noor, the Dean of the Faculty of Management and Economic UPSI. Please welcome.
Thank you, Ms. Amiza and Alif. Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Seri Idris Jalla, President and Chairman of Pemandu Associates and Wife, Yang Berbahagia Datin Seri. Yang Berbahagia, Profesor Datuk Dr. Mat Amin Mattaf, Vice Chancellor, Universiti Pendidikan Sultan Idris and Wife, Yang Berbahagia Datin. Yang Berusaha, Profesor Dr. Abdul Rahim Razali, Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic and International UPSI, UPSI's top management, industry representatives, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to say thank to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity to sit together for a very meaningful event with Datuk Seri Idris Jalla. A resounding welcome to each of you as we gather today for a truly exceptional occasion, one that exemplifies the convergence of knowledge, passion, and the multifaceted essence of industry leaders. As the Dean of the Faculty of Management and Economics, it is both an honor and a privilege to extend my heartfelt greetings on this remarkable day. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce to you a concept that has taken root as a beacon of inspiration and innovation, captain of the industry, the other side of me, talk series. We began this program in 2023 with the visionary initiative that was crafted with the intent of not only unveiling the brilliance of industry luminaries, but also delving into the personal dimensions that make them so extraordinary. It is a platform where these captains of industry share their experience, their expertise, while also revealing the intriguing passions that shape their minds and their lives outside the boardroom. So hence the name, The Other Side of Me. As I mentioned, we began this series in 2023, exactly on June 14. And on that remarkable day, we had the privilege of hosting Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Sri Dr. Azman Hashim, who shared his life journey and graced us with a musical performance alongside an orchestra. The collaboration between UPSI and the University of Malaya at that time turned the event into an unforgettable symphony of experiences. And now, on the wings of that resounding success, we gather today to welcome our second luminary, Yang Berbahagia Datuk Sri Idris Jalla. Datuk Idris Jalla has been known as a transformation guru of the international acclaim, and his journey has left an indelible mark on diverse factors. From his days at Shell and Malaysia Airlines to his groundbreaking role in Pemandu Associates, his commitment to progress and innovation has been nothing short of exemplary. His international engagements have not only fortified Malaysia's standing, but also enriched the global discourse on transformation and leadership. Today, we have the distinct privilege of hearing from Datuk Sri Idris Jalla himself about his remarkable journey and the insights he has gathered along the way. Yet, what sets this talk series apart in the invitation to witness the other side of these luminaries, and we shall experience the harmony between their professional expertise and their personal passions. We shall discover the symphony of their accomplishments and their artistic pursuits, their intellect and their creativity. As we gather to listen to Datuk Sri Idris Jalla today, let us embrace the holistic essence of leadership. Let us remember that greatness stems not only from professional achievements, but also from the zeal with which we pursue our passions. It is in this confluence that true inspiration flourishes. I extend my deepest gratitude to Datuk Sri Idris Jalla for joining us today and for embracing this platform to share his insights and passions. To all present, I encourage you to immerse yourselves fully in this enlightening experience, for it is through such engagements that we ignite the spark of transformative change. Ladies and gentlemen, I would also like to take this opportunity to thank all the people behind the success of this event, especially from the Faculty of Management and Economics, as well as from the various departments at the University Pendidikan Sultan Idris. Thank you for gracing this occasion with your presence, Datuk Sri. Let us eagerly anticipate the profound wisdom and captivating reveals that await us. Thank you. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Doctor, for your remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, now we are honored to welcome our esteemed Vice Chancellor of University Pendidikan Sultan Idris, UPSI, Yang Berbahagia Professor Datuk Dr. Mat Amin bin Maktab to deliver his welcoming speech. Please welcome Yang Berbahagia Prof. Datuk.
A'udzu billahi minasy syaithanir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala asyrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi washabbihi ajmain. Yang berbahagia Datuk Seri Idris Jala, Presiden and Chairman of Pemandu Associates and Wife, yang berbahagia Datin Seri Pangan Yu, kita berikan tepukan kepada yang bahagia Datuk Seri. Seterusnya yang berusaha Profesor Dr. Abdul Rahim Razali, Deputy Vice Chancellor of Academic International LUPC, give a big hand to Prof. Rahim. And Prof. Asri, the captain of today's event, give a big hand to Prof. Asri and the team. UPSIS top management industry representative, ladies and gentlemen. I try not to use text because normally when I speak using text, then I will be mumbling here and there. Ladies and gentlemen, it is truly an honor for all of us to host Yang Berbahagia Datuk Seri Idris Jala, a prominent Malaysian leader who only not serve our beloved country but also at the global arena. Give a big hand, Datuk Seri, for making your time. I get to know Datuk Seri in 2016 when I hosting him for a talk in Boston, where there's a meet and greet event with the students, Malaysian students in Harvard, MIT and Tufts University. Listening to his talk, to his insights and stuff, you know, it is truly inspirational. And I'm proud, you know, because some of your practices, I have copied it and implemented in UPSI. Thank you so much again, Dato' Sri. Give a big hand to him. Dato' Sri task is not easy. As the chairman of Pemandu before, you know, he's trying to change the way we do things. Normally in Malaysia, we do things in silo, very confined to our institutions, agencies and ministries. But with the presence of Pemandu, by capitalizing the use of data and local talents, Dato' Sri managed to help and drive Malaysia towards a certain greater heights. Therefore, it is truly important for us all here to spend our times to listen, to learn, to immerse, and also to practice with what Datuk Sri will share with us. And I would like to urge you to, you know, take notes on all the ideas, ask questions, and exchange numbers so that at any time you can be in touch with him, his wonderful team, and UPSI will have a greater benefit and we can drive our beloved university to a certain height. Again, Dato' Sri and Datin Sri, thank you so much for coming to UPSI. It's not that far after all, you know, it's just 45 minutes from KL, and we hope to see you more in UPSI. And Dr. Asri, please think of how we can make Yang Bahagia Datuk Sri as a prominent figure and also lecturer or professors in UPSI. And with that, I thank you.
Thank you, Yang Berbahagia, Prof. Datuk, for your insights. Now, we would like to present a montage in honor of Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Sri Idris Jala. Thank you for the montage.
Yang berbahagia, Datuk Sri Idris Jalla, the captain of the industry and a true transformation guru. Today, Datuk Sri Idris Jalla will be sharing his topic, Six Secrets to Transformational Leadership, Revolutionizing Malaysia's Higher Education Landscape Through Transformation Leadership and Policy Reforms. It will bound to be enlightening and thought-provoking.
Datuk Sri Idris Jalla's journey from a humble beginning to becoming a renowned transformation guru is inspirational. His dedication, tireless efforts, and unwavering commitment to excellence have shaped him into a true icon of leadership.
Yang berbahagia, Datuk Sri Idris Jalla is a man of exceptional wisdom and a visionary leader who has not only transformed organizations but also impact societies positively. He has served in various capacities, including as a minister in the Prime Minister's department, and is widely recognized for his remarkable achievements. And now, the moment we have all been eagerly waiting for, please join us in welcoming our keynote speaker. Please welcome Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Seri.
Yang Berbahagia Profesor Datuk Dr. Muhammad Amin bin Taf, Yang Berbahagia yang berusaha Profesor Dr. Amin Rahim Razali, ladies and gentlemen, I really like your the montage. I look a little younger and that is very nice. I have some slides that I want to take you through, but since the topic, the theme is the other side of me, I will introduce the other side of me where I was born and bred. That's the long house I was born. I grew up in the village. The first time I came to town, I was 15 years old. That's when I saw a television. The next photograph, that was my father. When he was younger, he actually looked like that. And he was a teacher. He opened many of the schools in Sarawak, in my village. He was my teacher in primary one, all the way up to primary six. So he taught me in the classroom. He was also my teacher at home. Cannot avoid do the homework. So he told me the most important thing in life is education. So this is very important. Some of you may not know it. How I got my name was actually from my uncle of mine. The story, I'm not entirely sure which is the correct one, but there were two versions. One was, the name was given to me by a district officer. He said, give him the name Idris. The other one, the story was from my uncle, after Sultan Idris Tanjung Malim. Actually, that's the other side. I'm not sure which one is true. Depending on where I speak, I might tilt it the other way around. If you look very closely at that photograph, the other side of me, on your right-hand side, you see some human skulls. My great-great ancestors were headhunters. Their hobby in life was to go to another village, chop the head of some of those people, bring their skulls, and put it in the longhouse as a trophy. I'm okay, by the way, don't worry about me. But that's the other side of me. Next. Subject I want to talk to you about today is this notion of transformation. How do you go about doing it? My formula is a very simple diagram called yin and yang diagram. If you want to transform an institution or a company or any organization, there are two things you need to do. The first one is the leadership must behave in a manner that's transformational. You must behave in a transformative manner. The other one is, it's not enough for the leaders in that organization to behave like that, but the people in the organization must embrace a new way of working. Only when you have transformational leadership plus a new way of working, then only the organization can run. Leadership without followers is of no use. Only when the leaders have people that follow them and embrace a new way of working, then it will happen. But today, I'm not going to talk about all of that because I don't really be here for a very long time. But I do want to talk about just transformational leadership so that it applies to you as you think about what you do. The request by the organizers was that they want me to talk about higher education, how it applies to higher education. So I'm not going to talk about Malaysia Airlines, the time I was in Shell. I'm not going to talk about the time I was in the government. I'm talking specifically about higher education. A few months ago, last year rather, the Minister of Higher Education, he called me. Dato' Sri Khalid Nordin, he said, Idris, I want you to become the chairman of the National Review Committee to review our entire education policy and do this. And I said no to him in the beginning until I understood what he wanted me to do was very similar to what I thought, because as far as I'm concerned, there's nothing wrong with the blueprint, nothing wrong with the policy. The problem is implementation. That is the problem. So I told the minister, I agree to take on the role only on condition that we don't go and review the policy, because that would be a waste of time. What I suggest that we do, look at the roadblocks. What are the things that prevent higher education from moving up to the higher scale? Identify them and then begin to address them. Then I think we can make progress. So he agreed. There were really two chunks of roadblocks, things that prevent you from moving very far. As a university, whether you are UPSI or MU or USM, the first one is the quality of the student intake that you receive. If the quality of the students that come to you is already broken, you have a problem, because you are fixing, you are repairing. So you need to improve the scholastic record right from preschool to primary school to secondary school, and then they come to you, then you take them from there. But if you have to do remedial work to deal with that, it's a huge problem. So that's first problem. Second problem, there are a lot of roadblocks. I will cover a little bit what are the roadblocks that prevent the universities, the institutions of higher learning to move further on. Let me take the first one. The first one is that the Prime Minister, Dato' Sri Najib, he called me into his office when I was a minister many years ago. He said, Idris, I want you to do something that has not been done before. Can you tell me why is it that we have the same curriculum, the same teacher salary, the same textbook? How come some of our primary schools and some of our secondary schools are better than others? Can you tell me why they are better than others? I want you to tell me next week, why are they better than others? So that we will ask all the rest to follow them, the 1%, the top 1%. If you take the top 1% of the primary schools in Malaysia, the top 1% of the secondary schools in Malaysia, they are as good as any top universities in the world. Top primary and secondary schools in the world. Sama juga gaji. Curriculum sama juga. Textbook sama juga. How come? The facilities pun sama juga. How come? This was the challenge. So if we can find a way to get the lessons learned from that, that is good. So the Prime Minister told me, next week you come and tell me what to do. That was the impossible. So in leadership, I return back to the point, the first principle of transformational leadership, you must set targets that are impossible to achieve based on the current way of doing it. Why is that important? It's because if the current way of doing is impossible to achieve those tall and tough targets, you have no choice but to find a new way how to do it. This new way how to do it, it's the one that will make it possible. So what we then did was, I told the Prime Minister, I think what we'll do is, I can't tell you why the 1% is better than others. why don't we do this? We rank all the schools in Malaysia all together, both the primary school and secondary school, based on the education results, the public exam results of all the primary and secondary schools for the last 10 years, and rank them from number one to number 10,000, one by one. We did that in 2 weeks. Very easy to do. If you understand pivot table, you put inside there, you put the average put the scores, and then you rank them. You know immediately which are the top 1%. So that's first. Then we will say, if we then know the top 1%, we study them, which is the third point. We study them. What is it that they are, why are they different? Why are they the top 1%? And also we said, let's reward them, give them a reward for being the top 1%. The fourth thing that we did was, we captured the learnings from all the top 1% of the schools, primary and secondary school, and put them in the school improvement toolkit. So that the school improvement toolkit is then shared with all the other 99% of the schools so that they can learn. Which is then we then launched the school improvement toolkit. After we did that, at the end of the year, we rank the schools again, one by one. All the schools are ranked based on the exam, public exam results of the school. And finally, publish the ranking. This is quite radical because the teacher said, if you publish the ranking of my school, if my school is number 10,000, no parents will send their students to my school. What's the problem with that? Because if nobody wants to go there, that means you're lousy lah. Then they shouldn't have any students there. But it was very painful that the teachers had a huge problem with this. Because when we did this, it became apparent also that there were a lot of people, teachers, who were teaching English, for example, in certain schools. The people, the students were failing the English exam. So we did actually get the English teachers to sit for the Cambridge placement test. The 70,000 teachers who teach English, you know the results? 70% of them did not pass the test. If the teachers failed the test, what chance would the student have? So the problem they had was, when we wanted to put them to the test, they said, the unions came and asked us, are you going to sack us if we fail the test? I've been teaching English for the last 10 years or 20 years. We told them, no, we're not going to sack you. We're going to send you for remedial classes so that you can improve this. So that's how the union was okay. There was another problem. Many of the teachers received an English allowance for teaching English. The unions also asked us, if they fail the test, are you going to remove the allowance? The answer is no. Because we're not here to make life difficult for them. We're here to improve. So we told them, we're not removing the English allowance, but you have to improve your command of the English language. Because it was so poor among so many of them. That's how we started. So over a 2-year period, we ran the program on that to improve them. So there's a lot of things that was done. Next slide, please. So of the 9,000 schools, 128 schools were among the top 10. It's not, as I said before, nothing to do with better curriculum, nothing to do with better facilities, nothing to do with better salaries, because the gaji pun sama. Facilities is the same. The books are the same. Next slide. The second thing about leadership is to be able to measure what I call true north. Leadership are people who are very clear about the measure of success. If leaders are not clear about the measure of success, the whole organization is confused. In the example that I gave here, I think the best example of a measure of true north for success for a school, to my mind, is public exam results, because it's common amongst all. That's why 99% of the world use this as the measure of success for schools. The 1% believe that you don't have to sit for exams, and you can put people grow like wild mushroom, it's okay. But I don't believe that. So when we studied the 128 schools, it was very clear there were four things that determined the success. Four, not three, but four. At the center of it all, the students in those schools must have a desire to learn, must have a passion to want to learn. Because if the students don't want to learn, whatever attempts by the principal and the teachers and the parents is not going to work. But the center of it all must be the student. Everything to do with improving education begins with the standard student in the center. And the triangle that you see there is the role of the principals or the headmasters and the roles of the teachers and the roles of the parents. All three of them must focus on the student. Don't focus on the Putrajaya. If you focus on Putrajaya, focus on anything else, if you focus on beautifying the building, you will never going to improve it. You have to focus on the student. Get the student to want to learn. So these are the three players. Everybody else outside should, in my view, be working to help the principal, to help the teachers, and to help the parents to make it work. I believe that everybody in the ministry, people in Putrajaya, they are supporting actors down below. All other players are supporting actors. But at the center of the universe must be the student, focusing on the student. She was the Chan, she was the principal of Sri KDU. Why did I go there? Because in the year 2012, among the 65 countries in the world for PISA exams, and I think for TIMSS, they were one of the top in the world. So I was quite curious, what is it that they're doing there? So when I went there, it was quite incredible. That in Chan requires all the teachers to come to the classroom during the holiday to prepare for the next term. And I was amazed. Literally, we had a room from here, the table was from here to the edge there. All on the table were manual, every subject. How to teach geography, how to teach history, how to teach mathematics, every single one. All the manuals were written by them based on the best teacher in that school for that subject. And they use that, it's called structured pedagogy, to teach all the other teachers so that they can become the best maths teachers, the best geography teachers, the manuals there. So for 14 days, they sit in the classroom to prepare for the next term. This is what Datin Chan does. And for I also went to Sekolah Ulu Lubai. Sekolah Ulu Lubai, there's a principal called Cikgu Jaul. Sekolah Ulu Lubai is an Iban school, very remote school, far from Limbang. It's flooded almost two times a year. Very, very poor. The kids, they are poor. But they won so many awards, 100%. The students get A's. So it's quite amazing to see what they do there. So I went there, my wife actually visited. They won so many awards. Public speaking, chorus award. The most amazing thing that they won was Tembikai competition, not bowling. They had a bowling competition, they also won it. So I asked them, how do you learn how to do bowling? There's no bowling alley in Sekolah Ulu Lubai. They said, oh, we learn how to do bowling using Tembikai. So desperate. They come to town, they menang juga. March pass also they won. I'm not kidding with you. If you go there, their awards for the school are outside the classroom, along the corridor, along the pathway, is full of awards. That school was incredible. Chegu Jaul was invited to speak at a conference like this among teachers. Then he told a story. There was one teacher in Kelantan that gave him a challenge. Chegu Jaul, you're lucky because your students happen to be hardworking. And why don't I send 20 of my students from Kelantan who cannot read and write to come to your school, you teach them to read and write. And the ministry, if the ministry agree, they will send them and put them there, pay for the course. Challenge accepted. 3 months later, all the Kelantanese kids who couldn't read and write, sent back to Kelantan, all can read and write. The same curriculum, the same teachers, the same facilities. It's because Cikgu Jaul, you know what time the kids come to school every day? 6:30. They turn up in school every day at 6:30 to learn how to brush teeth, discipline. And then every day, the meals are prepared by the parents. The parents are there from the longhouse to make the meals. The parents are, the meals are so good. Nobody wants to miss the meals. So they come to school, zero absentee. At night, the parents are sitting with them in the classroom doing the homework. How not to pass your exam with flying colors? Because the teachers are involved, principal is involved, everybody is involved. Cikgu Jaul tells me, every 2 years, federal government changes the teachers, bring new ones. But he said, when they come here, they have to follow what we do here in Sekolah Ulu Lubai. Whatever you do in Putrajaya, no, follow ours. 6:30 must come here. The parents do it together. He understood exactly what they were doing. It was quite incredible. I went to another school called, this is Sekolah Kebangsaan Taman Mega. This is Petaling Jaya. That lady, the principal, is Mrs. Koo. Exactly the same thing as Jaul, exactly that in Chan. They really get everybody to sit down and really, really work together, the principals, the school, and that is why they're very, very good. So everything I'm telling you is not rocket science. I teach at Harvard 2 times a year. There's a guy called Professor Rimmer. He did a lot of studies. The studies that Professor Rimmer's done in Harvard on education was, he said, the single biggest lever to improve student education, wait for it, is structured pedagogy. Structured pedagogy, that means a structured way of teaching, not the curriculum. The curriculum is the same, but the method of teaching is the key. So if you can find the best teachers in geography, the best teachers in history, the best teachers in mathematics, you then sit with those guys and let them write down the manual of how they teach. Some of you will remember, when you remember your teachers, your own teachers, when you were in school, you remember your best teacher. And if you ask the question, how come the teacher was the best teacher, you'll remember her or his method of teaching is different from the others. I used to have one teacher called Mrs. Huddleston. Our command with the English language was poor. Mrs. Huddleston taught us in Form 4 and Form 5, they taught us literature. We had to study Far From Madding Crowd. It's a very thick book. She had a method to say that, I want every single one of you next week to read chapter 1. Any word inside the book in chapter 1 that you don't know, you must look at the dictionary, write down the word in your book, and write the meaning in the dictionary. If you don't do that, I'm going to ask you to stand, the whole class. Second question, if you miss, if you don't do it, you're outside. The third one is work party on Saturday. That's what we did. I can tell you, in 1 year, our vocabulary exponential. Because that was a method of teaching. That was different and it was effective. I'm just citing this because nowadays there's so many tools available. There is YouTube, there's so many tools that's available for the teachers to use. But they have to look at the best way to get the teacher, the students to be curious and wanting to learn. Next. This is the school that I described, not only Sekolah Ulu Lubai, look like that, but they're very proud of the school. The students beautify the school, they cut the grass, they're very disciplined. And so I really am very impressed with that school. Now, what happened was, after 6 years of doing this, we were doing this. Look very carefully at the chart there. We rank all the schools in Malaysia, primary school and secondary school, in band 1 to band 7. The gray bar was what was the school, the total number of schools in band 1, band 2, and 3 in the year 2010. The red bar is the results of the schools in 2018. Right. So it's 16, is it? Yeah, 16. In this chart in a while now. You can see band 1 and 2, the improvement is 105% improvement in the ranking of the schools. There are so many schools that were improved, double the numbers that were in 2010. You will see a huge reduction in the schools that are in the band 6. Here is band 5, band 6 and 7. Huge reduction. So you can see huge progress there. I am totally convinced that to follow the 8-step process to do this, it's going to work. But it's not easy. In terms of leadership, it was very difficult to execute this because there were a lot of complaints. The principals were complaining because how can you rank my schools to be band 7? People don't come here. Actually, I prefer that because if you are schools in band 7 and nobody send their kids to the school have to close down. I prefer schools to close down rather than walking zombies. Walking zombie is no good. Better die rather than allow them to carry on. You know why? Because sending the kids to the school that's so bad is like sending them for life imprisonment. In the formative years when the kids don't learn, you have a huge problem. And so I really believe this. So unfortunately, this changing of government is a problem. To me, it's good to have changing of government. But when you change the government, you pick the good things and keep the good things. All the things that are no good, please throw them away. But remember, there are some good things in whichever government that's there. Always look for the good things. Keep the good things, throw away the no good things. Unfortunately, in my view, this was stopped. This ranking process, this whole thing was stopped. And that in 2018, I wish that they continue it. Next. So I now return to the second story. The second story is, how do we look at the issues, the roadblocks that are preventing the universities from improving? So this was the approach that was taken. It's very important that we do this. And I was the chairman of that, if you like, the review committee. There were a lot of people that were inside there. But we sent out a survey to all the universities. So you receive questionnaire, every single, all the universities, both public and private, they submitted full surveys to us in April 2023. And then we took 3 months to review every single one of them. Next slide, please. I think when we looked at this, there were a few issues that were, we categorized them. The first one was on the quality. How do we know which universities are really good? So the quality must be a measure of true north. The second measure of true north is profitability. If you don't make money, you don't have enough money to improve the school, you don't have enough money to invest in the school, you don't have enough money for R&D to do research, and therefore you cannot improve. And finally, student enrollment. So these are the three areas that we looked at. When you see this, I'm going to look this way. global ranking, Malaysia is number, the highest in Malaysia is only MU. That's still 65, number 65. We've been here for a very long time. None of our universities have reached Ivy League. So it's still a long way to go. UPSI is still 950. So of the schools that was ranked. So you have some way to go. There's a lot, the beauty my grandfather used to say, you know, the most important thing to do when you have a torchlight is to shine it in the dark. Do not shine the torchlight in the bright open because nobody will see it. But if you shine the torchlight in the dark, everybody can see it. So you have tremendous opportunity to jump up. And that's an encouragement to you. So if you look global, MIT is number one, Oxford number three. Student enrollment is actually still very low. Our total student enrollment is at 59.5%. And the target the government had put for student enrollment is 70%. We're still way off that as well. So you can see global enrollment 150% in Greece. Turkey is 117%. Australia is 114%. They have more students they put in than the capacity of the school, the university to take. Because they have make all sorts of things like dual courses run in a day rather than individual. And also employability. Malaysia's graduate employability stands at 92%, but the graduate employment is 73.5%. So the real numbers is more like 73.5%, because what they tend to do is that the data, when we look at the data, those people that they didn't get a job for a while, then they went to go and do another study, another degree. They said, oh, this one is not qualified, not in the data, but you should put it in there because they went to do another degree because they didn't have a job in the first place. So if you take the full employment data, the graduate employment data, actually our numbers are not that good. And 30% of them are unemployed. That's a problem too. And also 55% of the private education, higher education in Malaysia actually lose money. 64% of them have difficulty even paying their hutang. So we have a big problem. It's not easy problem. So when you look at the policy, it's not a problem the policy, it's a problem of roadblocks. Next slide.
Yeah. Check. So if you take a look at the next slide, we had the number of hindrance issues. There were 573 issues. There was, or 872 issues. These are the number of problems that the universities encountered. And we reviewed 45 policy documents. We also looked at these issues, and there were 134 universities, institutions of higher learning that gave us a response. So we got all of you, including UPSI. And it was a very big study that we did over a period of 3 months. Next slide. These were all the recommendations that were put there, but I'm not going to go through all of them. There were 29 transformative recommendations. There are 12 quick wins and 18 enablers. You can see every single one of them, they were there. If I can tell you some of them that were almost ridiculous, I tell you one because it sounded quite crazy. I was talking to a deputy VC because he looks after academic as well as international students. If any student from overseas come and do a degree here or in USM, if you do a degree, if you finish your degree, let's say you're from Nigeria, then you apply to do your master's degree, accepted, given a slot. The immigration rule says that Nigerian student must fly back to Lagos, must go back all the way to Lagos and fly back from there. What is that for? This is a big problem. We're creating difficulties for ourselves, those kinds of rules. Another problem, an example was, they were all inside this, and I'm not going to go through every single one of them. For example, the fees that are regulated by the ministry for every subject are controlled by the ministry. When we studied the fees, the level of the fees that were pegged, Some of them are lower than the cost to deliver that program. Let's say Bachelor of Pharmacy. The cost that is required to deliver the program is higher than the fees that are regulated. So even if you have 100% enrollment, you still lose money. In fact, the more students you have, the more you lose money. So you cannot make money when the fees are regulated like that. So what is the recommendation? Remove the regulation. Liberalize it. There are many things like that. Today, if the VC wants to start a new program, you cannot just put the new program there. You have to apply for permission. And it takes a long time for the ministry to approve it. Even if you have one program, you want to enlarge the classroom also. Just increase the classroom. Buka pintu dulu. That also have asked permission. No need all these. So all these we try to remove. Otherwise, there are a lot of problems. So to giving you a lot of latitude, because other universities in the world don't do this. Nobody doing this like us. Another thing that we saw was, many of the universities, they don't have enough donors that give them money for endowment fund. Our country is very, very poor in getting money for endowment. You know, one university, Harvard, has $59 billion US dollars of endowment fund. $59 billion. When we examine why, what is the reason why people want to donate? One of the things that we saw was, we have a tax rule that says any donation to endowment fund in Malaysia is subject to charitable bodies rules. That means if you put 10 million donation, 50% of the donation must be spent in year one. So that money cannot be invested by the university to generate enough interest to then run the program in perpetuity. So the donor, instead of donating 10 million for a chair, katakanlah, it must be 20 million because the first 10 million must be spent in year one. And the reason is very simple. We have our rules on endowment based on charitable bodies. That rule for charitable bodies, memang macam tu lah. Lain-lain tempat pun macam tu. It's memang like that. But not for endowment. Only Malaysia do it. So what we said, why we do this? Make life difficult. So it costs a lot more money for the donors to put it because it doubled the cost of providing the endowment. So this was the recommendations, many of them. We had so many recommendations like this. Every single one of them. I can tell you, we had a four-day workshop. You see the photo there. In the workshop, we brought the immigration people there, Mohi people there, finance people were there. Wow. Bukan main quarrel lah. A lot of family quarrel. Because some of the folks in immigration, they really want to think that some of the students that come here, we must look at them as criminals first. But we want to bring the students, we want Malaysia to become an education hub. But if you now want to catch everybody and make the rules so difficult for everybody, then nobody wants to come here. That's why in the UK, they're very frank. In fact, we suggested too, that one of the things that we recommend is that when people finish their degree here, foreign students, we should allow them to compete and get a job for 1 or 2 years. And there was a lot of argument. For 4 days, we quarreled. At the end of the 4 days, people normally stop quarreling after the third day, like they're tired of quarreling. So after the third day, they say, okay, like, we compromise. So there were some compromises. Another example was TVET. We have 1,500 institutions that provide vocational and training, technical training. When we look at them, Malaysia spends 3.8 billion ringgit a year for all those 1,500 institutions. the quality is varying from good to bad to ugly. The ugly ones are the graduates completely 90% tidak ada kerja, totally unemployed. But when you ask the students, why is it you come here and do a diploma in this course in this university or this institution? You know what they say? Oh, because the scholarship is good. The government gave me 500 ringgit to go and study this, that's why I come. Don't you realize that 90% of the students who come and do this diploma, they end up not getting a job? You see, today, the government is so kind, you see. So we give them, all of them, the same allocation every year, democratic style. I think we recommended that we should rank the TVET on employability of the graduates and the average salaries of the graduates. So if you are TVET that have the highest number of employability with high gaji, and the government should give more allocation, annual allocation. You should give less to those that don't bring people jobs. Because TVET is different from academia. When we said TVET, our focus on TVET is employment. This is key. So we should rank them on employability and average salary. And so we put all these recommendations, so we brought everybody, we kind of agreed. So then we had the minister coming in, all the DGs, all the KSU, semua, they agreed. So they got everybody to agree. We had a town hall event like this. We invited PM to come there and open it, launch it. Unfortunately, he was busy in Saudi. So he sent Deputy Prime Minister to come for the opening. All the recommendations were plastered on the wall. And to get everybody to agree, whole day we conducted an open day to get full agreement amongst all parties. After we finished then doing that, we wrote a cabinet paper so that the cabinet signed and approved. So all the recommendations in the 570-page document was approved and endorsed by cabinet, approved and endorsed by all the relevant ministries and all ministers. Of course, today we have a change of cabinet ministers lah. Now to start from beginning. Hopefully the new minister will embrace this. Hopefully there's not a new KSU, then they kept changing it bula. So we just hope and pray that the new minister want to continue lah. This is my issue. Because to me, I still remain convinced. Life is very simple. If you want to solve a problem, you must understand exactly what the problem is. If you don't understand the problem, then you cannot find the solution. I will say a quotation from me. This is from me. The solution or the treatment is to be found in the disease. Remember this. The treatment is to be found in the disease. Keep looking at the problem. The longer you look at the problem, the more you will discover the solutions to it. Someone once asked Einstein, if you have 40 minutes, how much of the time do you spend looking for the solution? He said, of the 40 minutes, maybe 10 minutes is looking for solutions. 30 minutes I'm looking at the problem. Because if you really understand the problem, then you can solve it. And how do you solve it, actually? Very simple. Don't start to reinvent it. Somebody somewhere in the world already know how to solve this. Cari saja. That's why I keep looking at the 1% of the school. Don't try to look for the solution. Just ask who else is doing it. Go there and learn from them. You know, my father was a teacher. He taught me one simple thing. You know, the word kiasu is a Hokkien word for hate to lose. By the way, if you Google it, kiasu is now in the Oxford English Dictionary. It means hate to lose. My father says, son, in Klabit, we also have the same word. It begins with K. It's called ketui. Ketui means burning desire to win. He says, if you want to be number one in class, it's very easy. Ask the question, who is currently number one? What's the name of that person? be his or her best friend. Find out exactly what he or she does in study. If he studies 4 hours a day, do 8 hours a day. If you study the books, this, does this, that's what you do, but do it to the power of 10. And just be the friend of that person. And test it after next term, you sure can. Boleh lawan, for sure one. That's a very simple thing. If you're working for sales, work for Shell, you want to be the best salesman, find out who is the best salesperson in the company. Be his or her best friend. Copy exactly what they do and do it to the power of 10. Itu saja. So if you spend a lot of time identifying the problem, once you know the problem, now you look around who is best practice. Jangan malu. Copy is a very good thing. Go there and find out exactly what they do. Be their friend. If you have to beg, beg. That's what you do. And if you do it, life is simple. Don't complicate life. If someone tells you the answer to this is a very complicated one, do not believe them. Life actually is very simple. Just find out who is the best in doing that, know what they do, distill it and do that. And watch the results. Let me return back to leadership. I've been very fortunate to have met many people. Jack Ma, Usain Bolt. By the way, Usain Bolt, a very interesting man when we brought him to Kuala Lumpur. And Richard Branson and all these guys. When you talk to them, they do this thing called the game of the impossible. First secret of leadership. Usain Bolt, we brought him here on stage in KL to talk about how did he become an athlete like that. And there was a question that was asked of him. Mr. Bolt, what is going on in your mind when you're at 100 meters Olympic champion of the world at the starting block? You know his response is, I'm only thinking of what I'm going to eat tonight. Why? That's the next question. You know what he said? 9 months prior to every race, I cannot just eat nasi lemak. I can't just eat KFC. Every diet is controlled. Every diet is controlled. Even his exercise regime. Every night for 9 months must sleep before 9 p.m. Cannot watch Netflix until 1. Tak boleh. So the game of the impossible is setting a target so high, you have to change your way of working. So in leadership, 90% of leaders will get buried underground, not fulfilling our full potential because of the fear of failure. We don't set ambitious target, we set realistic target. Next time when the bosses tell you to set realistic target, tell them, Idris Jala says, if you set realistic target, we are consigning yourself to walk down a path of mediocrity. So you must set an impossible target. Second, you must be clear in leadership about the measure of true north. What is the measure of success? So if you're not clear on measure of success, you let the whole organization become confused. So if you say for primary school and secondary school, the measure of success is public exam results, let that be clear. So everybody focus on that. Don't focus on beautifying the garden. Don't focus on swimming in the river. Focus on improving the exams. I know people will argue about this, and I'm very old school. I believe in very simple measure that will make people perform what you believe are the things that are important. The third one is discipline. Remember I told you about Cikgu Jaul? All students must be there at 6:30. Datin Chan says all teachers must, 14 days, must prepare for all the term. Discipline of action. If people have no discipline, they cannot get results. The fourth secret of leadership is to make sure that you have a winning coalition. That means a principal must get all the approval of the teachers to come along with them. You get the support from the parents, You get the support from the ministry, the ministers. If you can get all the support, you're going to fly. So if you do not get the support of people that buy in, you're not going to work. So when I was in Malaysia Airlines, I had to support of the union. Because if I remove 3,000 people, Izani was with me when we were working there. We had to remove 3,000 people in the first 2 months in Malaysia Airlines. And the union told me we will go on strike. So I called the president. I said, look, come here where you have a cup of tea with me. We are not going to make anybody forcibly redundant. We want volunteers only. We will sell the building, 130 million ringgit, to get enough money so that we tell people who want to go, they apply. If you don't want to go, please don't fill the form. Habis cerita. Then Aziz, the president of the union, say, macam tu okay lah. Dato' Sri, kita minum teh saja. No need to argue. Because if you want to stay, don't fill the form. If you want to go, fill the form. Itu saja. That's very simple. So if you do that, you will get people to come along with you. And it's very important. If you don't do it, you don't win coalition. You don't get people along with you. You cannot make tough decisions. You have to do it. It's very important. The fifth secret in leadership is about situational leadership. When you want to start a new journey to bring UPSI to the highest level that you want to bring it to, you cannot have too much democratic discussion in the beginning. Because you have too much democratic discussion, nobody will leave. Because you're just talking and talking and talking. You don't do. So the leadership must say, I am going to do this. I will talk with you for 3 months. After that, habis cerita. Kita mau jalan. Must do. So towards the later part, when they know how to do it, leaders must learn to let go. You can't just tell people what to do because they are already cleverer than you. You must let other people take over and run it. And the last thing about leadership is divine intervention. This is my last piece. The reason why I talk about divine intervention in leadership, in transformational leadership, is this. 70% of what happened to us has nothing to do with us. If you ask me today, and I ask you tonight, get a piece of paper, write down the 10 big things that happened in your life. Write them down. And ask one question. Did this thing happen exactly like this because you caused it to happen, yes or no? If you cause it to happen exactly like that, put a tick. If the answer is no, put an X. Count them. On my sheet, 70% of them are X. Got nothing to do with me. I never wanted to work for Shell. You know what my ambition in life was? I wanted to be a lawyer. All I wanted to do was study law. I didn't go and study law. Why? Because when I applied to go and do law in New Zealand, I told them, if you give me the place and the scholarship, please send it, don't send it to Barrio. No P.O. box, so I lost one. So send it to my auntie. But you know what? She was holidaying in Europe. By the time she came back, I was late by 2 days. 1 day or 2 days, I can't remember. So I never went there. My life collapsed, you know. So I went to USM. My whole life, I told myself, I remember in school, my principal said, pinpoint your primary goal. We have to stick down to something there on my bed was written, lawyer. Every day I look at this in the morning, every night I look at this. That was what I looked at the whole time. And suddenly I was not doing law. Wow. But you know, the best thing happened in USM. I found my wife there. And you know, when I was in USM, I then said, okay, I cannot be a lawyer, but I now want to be a professor. So I wanted to be a lecturer. So I was a top student of our graduating year. I got the Business School Award. So USM offered me the STS scheme. I was supposed to go to Pennsylvania to do my master's and PhD. Then I come back a lecturer. Then I left my books all day. Because I said I've changed from being a lawyer to be a professor. That's what I want to do. But on my final day in USM, I saw an advertisement. And this advertisement by Shell, they said, if you apply to join Shell, and if we invite you for interview, we'll pay for your ticket. And the interview was my hometown, Miri. I don't want the job, I just want the ticket. So I asked the question, how do I get this ticket? So I wrote a letter, a very cocky letter. It says like this, dear sir, I am the man you're looking for. I just wanted them to see that this guy is a special guy, like Jose Mourinho. And so they invited me for the interview. They gave me the job. So I went there, never mind, like, God, I'm on holiday anyway. So I took the job. So I started in June 2082. By September, I resigned. I put my letter of resignation. I said, I'm going to US to do a master's and PhD. They said, no, Idris, we want you to stay. We think you're good, but we don't like your hair. I had long hair because I was a student. But anyway, they persuaded me to stay, and they said, we'll sponsor you to do your master's, but no PhD. So I was Shell scholar. So I did my master's in Warwick. So that got nothing to do with me. I went to Sri Lanka too. That's got nothing to do. I never applied for the job. When I went to Mass, I also never applied for the job. When I went to become a minister, I also never applied for the job. So in my life, many things got nothing to do with me. Wow, like that. Actually, the other thing in life is this. Life is a continuous reduction of options. This is original for me. I have not seen it anywhere else said it. Because you remember when we were young, when you're young, you ask the guy, what is your ambition in life? In the morning, I want to be a fireman. In the afternoon, I want to be a rock star. In the evening, I want to be a billionaire. Everything can. When you grow older, suddenly you are not good in maths. Whoa, cannot be a doctor. Cannot be an engineer. Cannot be a dentist. I don't know what pulling teeth got to do with maths. But it's reduction of option. But when you go to university, they tell you, the VC will tell you, only 1 degree, you cannot hit 10, you know, reduced option. When you come out also, you want to join the bank, you cannot join Bank Bumi at the same time you want to join CIMB, tak boleh, one only. One to get married also, reduction of option. Everything reduction of option. Actually, when you say 70% of life is not within your control and life is reduction of option, it's very tough. Now, who is control of life? You have to be philosophical. In leadership, I believe, all leaders must learn to be humble. When you know that you're not in charge of life, you must be humble because vulnerability is a virtue in leadership. You must be humble because you don't control. You know what happened? 2020, 2021, the whole world was at its feet. We were on our knees because the virus, COVID-19, taught everybody, whether you're president, whether you're prime minister, whether you're a commoner, you are equal before the virus. You're not in control. So we must learn to be humble. So if you fail in achieving your target, your Olympics target, as long as you have done your best, it's okay. It's okay. And if your staff, they've done their best and if they fail, it's okay. What is not okay is you do not do your best. What is not okay is if you don't learn from your mistakes. Then it's not okay. So you must learn from your mistakes. That is very important. And the other thing that I find very interesting is this. How do you deal with whoever's in charge? If you talk to spiritual people, they will say it's God is in charge. Some people say it's faith. Some people say luck. Some people say, Lilian too will say it's feng shui. But in reality, it doesn't matter what it is. You're not in control. So I would suggest all leaders must be good human beings, first and foremost. If you're not a good human being, somehow the bad stuff is come to you. All bad people in this world, eventually, the sins will find them out. Secondly, very important to think about us. The more senior you become, the more you have to deal with the gray stuff. Let me talk about them in 3 circles. Black circle is the thing that's wrong to do, corrupt, illegal. the white circles are not corrupt, the right things to do proper. The gray circle is not exactly wrong, not exactly right, not exactly corrupt, not exactly incorrupt. This is the problem. There are many things like this. It's called ethics. How do you deal with ethics? Ethics, to me, is judged on the basis of your conscience. So if you use one mind to think about it, chances are, at some point, you're going to get it wrong. So in my corporate life, my adult life, I never decide on ethical issues alone. I do three things. Number one, I make sure that I bring the issue to my whole management team or my whole board so that many people are looking at it. Number two, all of them must write down the facts of the case on a piece of paper, write down the options and the pros and cons and debate it until they agree which is the best of the three options. The third thing to do, put it to a litmus test. That means if this document gets leaked in the social media, can you defend your action, yes or no? If you cannot defend your action in the public domain, chances are your decisions for ethical issues is wrong. This has I found to be the most practical things that I found useful in my life. And this is key to dealing with ethics. Never decide alone. And the last thing is the idea of self-renewal. I would encourage every single one of the leaders to spend time in solitude once in 2 weeks, quietly by yourself, looking at yourselves in the mirror, what you're doing right in your organization, personally, what you're not doing right, how can you make the improvements? If you don't keep looking at yourself in the mirror, then you will never discover that you have become so ugly. So this act of continuously looking at yourself in the mirror is a very important part of leadership. That is an encouragement that I will ask every single one of you to do. Returning back to the subject of education, if you ponder on the six secrets that I described before and reflect on the things I've made before, if you miss any of those steps, the secrets, you're not going to do it. So it requires everyone to be running with this. And the good news is, none of the things I tell you is rocket science. My father, I said, the simplest guy that I've ever met in my life, Kiasu and Katui. You want to be number one? Find out who is currently number one. Be his or her best friend. Find out how he or she does it. Double it or triple it. And if you do it, you will find that you make so much progress in your life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dato' Sri, for that inspiring presentation. Dato' Sri, please remain on the stage for the Q&A session. And we hope that all of us can press this knowledge from your valuable sharing. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll now open the floor for a brief Q&A session. Please feel free to share your question with our Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Sri Idris Jala. Any question from the top management?
I have one question for you. At first, it's my great honor to be here because I'm an international student here. I come from China, and your topic, a very interesting because I can find a lot of similarities between Malaysia and China in high education. You shared a lot about the current situation about the Malaysia high education. I can say there are a lot of challenges also in China. So I can learn a lot from what you are sharing for all of us. And the one question is, what makes you have such kind of aspiration to sustain the leadership? Yeah,
thank you.
That's all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome to Malaysia. I don't know how long have you been living here now, studying here?
Yeah, I have been here almost 1 year.
Oh, okay. You're still new.
Yeah.
But I'm sure you'll enjoy the rest of your time here. But I must say, for those that don't know it, China is making tremendous progress in education by leaps and bounds. On TIMSS and PISA, I think Shanghai ranked number one in the world, actually, on the international test for PISA, TIMSS, for mathematics. So they made a lot of progress. But they're sending a lot of their students to study abroad. So it's not a country that is sticking for themselves within the same cocoon. So her question to me is that, what is the thing that drives me
yes.
to keep on doing this? I would tell you, it's making sure that you choose something that you do that you're passionate about. Mm. If you ask me to go and work for a very boring, routine type of job as a cashier in a bank, I think I'll be fired in the first 3 months. Like, I cannot tahan. And I do want to do, you must look for a job that you're passionate about. Mm. And that's the key. And if you don't have a passion for what you do, you cannot last. So over in my life, I've always been involved with anything to do with transformation, anything to do with business turnaround. I came and did those jobs. And you notice, I never applied for those jobs. They came because somebody asked, they said, this is a guy that can do this. So I think if you're passionate about what you do and focus on doing it, people, your reputation will precede you, and then people will knock on the door. And that's how you get it. But I think work on doing something that you're passionate about. My wife is very supportive. When I went to Malaysia Alliance, she said, maybe this time round you will fail. Because I worked for Shell for 23 years. But she said, I will give you the permission to fail. This idea of giving permission to fail is a very important part of your ability to continue, your drive to continue. Because once you know you can fail, you only learn one lesson. Failure is never a failure until you stop learning from it. So learning from the failure is a very important part of your striving to pursue. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much. So we can learn that not only just focus on the leadership. So you gave us a good lesson for life wisdom,
thank you.
I think. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. We have time for one more question to ask for Datuk Sri. Any question?
Yeah, we have one.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, Datuk Sri. Welcome to UPSI, the most historical university in Malaysia. So I'm Nuri. I'm the president of Student Representative Council, or we call it MPP. I have one question for Datuk Sri. What is Datuk Sri's suggestion regarding the skills required by student leaders, considering AI or artificial intelligence will dominate in the next 5 years or 10 years in future, because we want quality leaders in the future for our country, Malaysia? Thank you.
Thank you. I agree with you. Your university is one of the oldest in terms of history. I was looking at the museum today. Started in 1922. Quite incredible. So congratulations for such a long life. So what are the things that my advice to student leaders to go forward? Follow the 6 secrets. Always put the game, the impossible, set a target that is so high that it's impossible to achieve based on the current way of doing it.
So you're then forced to look for a new way to do it. Number two, be clear about your measure of success, the true north, so that you focus on the things that matter. Number three, make sure you put up a program so that you will implement it in discipline, discipline of action. Number four, you must win coalition, bring people along with you. No leaders can be successful unless they are successful in bringing followers to come along with them. The fifth is about situational leadership. In the beginning of the journey, as leaders, you must be directive. Later part of the journey, learn to let go, empowering. Learn to let go. And the final one is divine intervention. Pray for divine intervention. And so, and I think if you do all this, you'll be surprised the kind of things that you will discover. But most human beings, intelligent people, I would say this. Intelligent people have one problem. And that includes many of you in the academia. Intelligent people seldom go beyond the boundaries of their self-imposed limitation. The more intelligent you become, the more you rationalize why it cannot be done. And you convince yourself it cannot be done. And in fact, you should become a lot more innocent as children. Suspend all the self-imposed limitations. Because that's the reason why intelligent people suddenly, sometimes, become a problem to themselves. They are the worst possible enemies. So if you start by putting the impossible targets, it will force you out from your intelligent syndrome. And therefore, you will now have to remove them. The sky should be the limits. The floor cannot be the limits. So when I say this, don't feel shy about it. When I was in Shell, my old boss in Shell once said like this, you know, Idris, there are many intelligent people, clever people in Shell. That is a problem. He said this, there are too many clever people who are stopping the other clever people from doing the clever things. So I would say today, you are just like Shell also, very clever people. Suspend some of those cleverness, be a little bit more childlike and innocent, and look for the solutions that are not conventional. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Sri, for your input. Ladies and gentlemen, now we have reached the end of the first part of our program. After such a stimulating session, it's time for a well-deserved high tea. We invite you to enjoy the delightful spread of refreshment while networking. Please welcome. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the second part of our program, an engaging and mesmerizing segment,
The Other Side of Me.
A glimpse into the man behind the accolades, the passions, and the insights that define him. Without further ado, to welcome Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Seri Idris Jalla.
Check, check, check. 1, 2, 1, 2.
A bit louder.
Check, check. Louder. Check, check. Ladies and gentlemen, I love music, in particular the blues. I'm a big fan of the blues gang. So all those guys in the blues gang are my friends. I know all of them. They're kawan lamara. So during the pandemic, I had nothing to do because we were stuck in the house. I had nothing to do. I started to build my own guitars. This is one of them. I sat down and learned how to do on YouTube, learn how to do soldering, learn how to buy the parts and do all the things. So this is one of my guitars. So I'm going to sing a song by the blues gang. The song is actually called Malaya Blues, but I've changed it to my own version called Malaysia Blues lah.
Jehovah rule. You're gonna meet a lot of people who appreciate the rhythm blues. You're gonna pick up your guitar, turn on the radio. It's hard to satisfy everybody with whatever you're doing, 'cause people got their own taste. You don't have a hard feeling. At least you try your best. It's up to them to digest, 'cause all I know is rock and roll. I got Malaysia blues. 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 Each and every day that I choose. Thank you. got Malaysia blue. I got Malaysia blue. I got Malaysia blues. I got Malaysia blues. I got Malaysia blues. It's an every day that I choose.
Thank you. For the great.
Thank you. Thank you. So is there somebody else going to sing?
Thank you, Dato' Sri, for the great performance. You are truly a gifted person. Round of applause, everyone. Dato' Sri, kindly remain on the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, now, we would like to invite Yang Berbahagia, Professor Datuk Dr. Mat Amin bin Maktaf, our beloved Vice Chancellor, to join Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Sri Idris Jalla, on the stage. Please welcome.
Saya berharap tiada siaran langsung dan tiada recording kerana tak tahu sejauh mana dia akan menjadi sumbang dan sebagainya. I will try my very best because I haven't played guitar for quite a number of years. But due to request from Dr. Asri, I will try my very best to... I'm not as good as you, but
just following you.
Just try the impossible, so we'll make the possible, inshallah. We're gonna dedicate a song from Beatles. Okay, semula. Yesterday, suddenly,
game to play. Now I need a place to hide away. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Why she have to go?
Give a big hand, everyone.
Dan jangan sebarkan video yang sumbang itu. Terima kasih.
Thank you yang berbahagia Datuk Sri Idris Jala and yang berbahagia Profesor Datuk Dr. Man Amin bin Maktaf for the mesmerizing performance. Datuk Sri and Datuk, please remain on the stage.
As we near the conclusion of this momentous event, we shall express our profound gratitude to Yang Berbahagia Datuk Sri Idris Jala. To mark this occasion, we have prepared a special memento of our honorable guest. We would like to invite Yang Berusaha Dr. Siti Zubaidah binti Zakaria, the director of the program, to accompany Yang Berusaha Associate Professor Dr. Muhammad Asri bin Muhammad Noh, the Dean of Faculty of Management and Economics UPSI, to join us on the stage for the presentation of memento. Thank you, Yang Berbahagia Prof. Datuk, for the presentation of memento. A picture speaks a thousand words, and capturing this memorable day is a must. Now, we will have our group photo. We kindly invite everyone to join us for a photography session with our Captain of the Industry, Yang Berbahagia Datuk Sri Idris Jala.
Please rise. Please rise. Diminta para hadirin untuk berada di tengah-tengah dewan untuk sesi fotografi. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated.
On behalf of the Faculty of Management and Economics, University Pendidikan Sultan Idris, we extend our deepest gratitude to Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Seri Idris Jala, for gracing us with his wisdom and insights.
As we conclude this remarkable event, we wish to express our heartfelt thanks to Yang Berbahagia, Prof. Datuk Dr. Man Amin bin Mantaf, the Vice Chancellor of UPSI, and everyone who joined us today. Your attendance has made this event truly exceptional.
We hope the knowledge and inspiration gained here today will continue to guide us in our pursuit of excellence.
As we wrap up this event, may I kindly request everyone to rise for the singing of Ibu Kandung Suluh Budiman. On the next occasion, wishing you all a wonderful evening ahead. Thank you and goodbye. Signing off, your MC, Ameza Sayan Anak Endawi
and Muhammad Alif bin Muhammad Shakir.
Thank you.